Welcome inside Castle Coliseum. You're watching the ACC on ESPN here in Blacksburg. It's the first of six games headed your way on ESPNU as number 19 West Virginia takes on Virginia Tech. Alongside of ACC legend Corey Alexander, I am Roy Philpott. And Corey, West Virginia has been outstanding this year defensively.
And Bob Huggins has a defense that matches his personality. And more importantly, what they do in the defensive end turns into offense, averaging 29 points a game off turnovers and one of the top 15 teams in scoring offense in the country.
Number 19, WVU, coming in at 10-1. Virginia Tech at 8-4, the final non-conference tune-up before league play hits this weekend. Virginia Tech in the home whites, WVU in the blue and gold as we are underway in Blacksburg. And West Virginia controls the opening tip. Hokies in a man-to-man defense. Both teams begin league play on Saturday. Outside, Devin Williams baseline count it.
And Devin Williams showing you his soft touch on the outside. He's a guy that's known for what he's able to do on the interior, but showing a nice touch. And more importantly, the score sets up the pressure for West Virginia.
And that pressure has been incredible so far this year, Corey.
And that's one of the things when you look at pressure teams, if you're unable to score, you can't really get into it. So you have to have an offense that matches in order for you to be able to really get into your style of play.
These two teams very familiar with each other, an early turnover. And the Mountaineers faithful very well represented today here in Blacksburg, a short drive from the state border.
Well, and coming into the game, all I saw was West Virginia colors coming in. I didn't see anyone in Virginia Tech, so a sellout crowd today. But a lot of those tickets were bought by the Mountaineer faithful.
Mountaineers led by Devin Williams, 41. Honorable mention, all Big 12 already with a basket today. WVU picked six in the Big 12 preseason poll. Perhaps a little bit ahead of schedule based off those early prognostications. Here's the miss and the rebound controlled by Virginia Tech. Baseline Hudson. And the basket will not count. It's called for the offensive foul. Now the Hokies without the services of Chris Clark, a talented freshman from Virginia Beach. Zach Ledé, the transfer from USF, paces Virginia Tech in scoring at just under 15 points per. Clark broke his fifth metatarsal over the Christmas holiday. That didn't sound very good, and he had surgery yesterday. He's actually right behind the Virginia Tech bench this afternoon.
And
big loss.
Yeah, the injury actually occurred while he was at home working out and wasn't in the organized team practice. And that you never want your players to stay home and do nothing, but they also have to be very careful of what it is they do.
Good defense by Hudson, and the rebound controlled by Blackshear. Devin Williams was shaken up momentarily, but appears to be okay.
Seems to be favoring that right hand. You have to keep an eye on that with Williams. That's one of those ones, a big tough guy like that goes away. It had to be pretty painful.
The day inside and the basket. Gary Blackshear puts Virginia Tech on the board.
Kerry Blackshear gives Virginia Tech some size on the interior, but he's also very talented and skilled on the perimeter. Not a guy that's going to be able to beat you up physically, but wins plays with a little more finesse, but did a great job finding his way open in the basket.
Tied at two, more than 2 minutes in here in Castle Coliseum. There's the quick trigger. Dexter Miles Jr., the miss. And Devin Williams fouled from behind on the floor.
And that's one of the areas where Devin Williams is so dangerous on the floor. You see, he's still favoring that right hand and actually going to check out of the game. Coach Huggins going to get him a sub, make sure that he's okay. But Devin Williams in West Virginia leads the country in offensive rebounds at 18 a game. And Devin Williams already starting off with that. And Blackshear having to go to the bench with his second foul early.
So that's an early developing storyline. And if Williams is banged up, the entire complexion of this Mountaineers program changes. Carter off the glass with a left hand.
And you'll see West Virginia run a number of what are called flex cuts off the baseline to get their guards open, but they have a number of strong guards capable of finishing in the paint.
Already the Mountaineers full court pressure taking a toll. And they thought about it. Outside now to Hudson. Now the sweet dish and strip by Carter. He's one of the best defensive players in the Big 12. Pretty fast break and the finish.
And that is it, turning defense into offense. Carter with the great hands on the strip. And as you see, getting in there and then running the break, Carter as well as Daxter Miles sharing the basketball. And this is the way that West Virginia plays, 29 points per game off of turnovers and getting out in transition. They're not necessarily a great half-court team as of right now, but when you can play this way, it always makes the game much easier for you.
The clock stopped after the main basket. Two trips to go down here. We're just trying to get the time on this one.
A brief stoppage in play due to the clock stopping about 60 seconds ago. Our veteran officiating crew, led by Roger Ayers, going back to the replay. Another look at the fast break. That's just pretty basketball.
It is beautiful basketball. And Miles with a great pass. He barely got it in his hands before he was making the touch pass back to Carter for the layup. And this West Virginia team, they play together. And that's one of the things that Bob Huggins loves about his team, is that they will share the basketball. They play together. They don't play selfishly. And that's a strong characteristic of the style of play that Coach Huggins wants to be able to institute at Morgantown.
Talking to Coach Huggins this morning, Corey, really isn't sure what kind of team this is going to be this year. He wants to see more toughness, but they're 10-1. Their lone loss was against top 10 Virginia. They're off to a pretty good start, aren't they?
Well, the toughness level for Bob Huggins is different than it is for everyone else. I don't know if a team can ever actually be tough enough for him. I played against his Cincinnati teams, and I don't know if they were tough enough for him, but they probably were the toughest teams I ever played against. I mean, when you start thinking about Corey Blunt, Nick Van Exel, Bosic, the groups that he had there, and then moving forward to Danny Fortson, who was a teammate of mine with the Nuggets, Reuben Patterson, who I played against in the NBA, they don't get any tougher than the guys that Bob Huggins has developed.
Can I get a Kenyon Martin in there, too?
It's so hard to get everybody in because all of them were tough guys.
So they changed the clock to 16:48 after the lengthy delay. Roger Ayers officiated one Final Four in his career back in 2012. Makes the right call, and here's a foul against Javon Carter.
And that's the one area that you have to be careful with when you play the style of play that West Virginia does, is you can often get guys in foul trouble, but believe it or not, they have depth. They have a number of guards that can come in and play the same style in order to be able to help out their pressing style.
Hudson at the strike, 58% this year, misses the first of two. There's our first look at Buzz Williams' second season. It really was a coup to get him from Marquette, trying to rebuild, revamp this program. And by most accounts, he's well on his way.
Yeah, I believe that he's doing it correctly here at Virginia Tech. He's got it going in motion the way he wants. Of course, the injury to Chris Clark doesn't help. But you know how you can tell that's the first shot of Buzz of the day. He still has his jacket on. I don't think we'll see that much longer.
He doesn't like to sit still very often, does he? He'll get after it. He'll work up a sweat. A couple of early whistles. He's down low.
You get a chance to see Chris Clark along the baseline. Clark leads all freshmen in the ACC in rebounding and has been a double-double threat all season long, playing in the first 11 games for Virginia Tech. So a big loss for Chris. And, you know, one of the things where Chris really would have been able to help Virginia Tech in this game, he's a great ball handler. Really plays a small four position, but a great ball handler and playmaker, and you need that playing against the Mountaineers at all positions.
It was Pierce called for the foul. He checks out. And the 7-footer Johnny Hamilton checks in. West Virginia out to an early 6-3 advantage here in Blacksburg. Done in the post.
And West Virginia, you see Macon coming in for Devin Williams. They have depth at every position, which allows them to be able to play this hard full-court defense for 40 minutes.
Dangerous pass. Somehow caught LeDain. Wide open with a flush. Well, a bit fortunate that time with the Hokies, but they'll take it. 4 minutes in, West Virginia, ranked 19th in the country, out to a three-point advantage here inside of Castle Coliseum. Blacksburg here inside of Castle Coliseum. 8-5 our score. Number 19 West Virginia, the 3-point advantage. And glad you could join us. Corey Alexander, Roy Philpott on hand. And Corey, West Virginia doing what it does best already with three forced turnovers.
And Virginia Tech, of course, going to need to have the ball in the hands of Devin Wilson, who has a 3-1 assist to turnover ratio, their point guard. But West Virginia knows that. So they're going to trap him pretty much every time he touches it and make someone else have to make a play for the Hokies.
Now, this is the fourth of 10 scheduled meetings between these two clubs. Remember, they were old Big East rivals. Bob Huggins said it was important to keep some close rivalries since WVU has moved to the Big 12. And usually these two teams play here. It's going to be close. Phillip for three. And Tariq Phillip has other intentions.
And Tariq Phillip knocking down the jump shot. That's one of Bob Huggins' concerns about this team, is if they can shoot it well consistently. But that would pretty much be unfair, wouldn't it? A team that plays this way defensively, if they can shoot from the perimeter consistently, you're talking about a national championship contender.
Mention it. The Mountaineers picked 6 in the rough and rugged Big 12 this year. I've seen them a couple of times already, Corey. I'm here to tell you, I think they can exceed those expectations.
I've only seen them once in the first 5 minutes of this game, and I agree with you. I don't think that this is a sixth-place team in the Big 12. I know the Big 12 is a very good conference, but I don't think that there are 5 teams that are going to be able to beat this team consistently.
Good tie-up by Devin Wilson in traffic. And the arrow favors the Hokies. And the foul right in front of the Virginia Tech bench.
And just like that, another turnover for Virginia Tech. And it's simply that West Virginia, and it's not as though the ball's not even in bounds. It's not as though they're underneath you, but they're the type of person that invades your personal space.
We don't like that as broadcasters.
It's just the guy that you want to say, hey, back up while you talk to me. But that's the way West Virginia plays. They get in your personal space.
A beautiful ball movement. Open look for Jayshon Page. 44% from three, but can't connect. And Williams on the offensive glass. Just checked back in. It'll stay with the Mountaineers. It's a New Year's 6, two of the greatest days for college football fans. It all starts at noon Eastern, New Year's Eve on ESPN. Then at 4 and 8, the playoff semifinal games between Oklahoma, Clemson, Michigan State, Alabama. Then on to New Year's Day, 3 more tremendous games to kick off 2016. All games, of course, on ESPN, streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app. Of course, the big news out of Clemson yesterday, Dabo Swinney sending 3 players home from the Orange Bowl, including one of the top receivers for the Tigers, and Deion Kane, a Florida native, backup kicker Ammon Lacob, and also J.J. McCullough, reserve tight end. Loss of Kane, Corey, I think is going to be, or could be, critical against the Sooners.
It could be very critical, and of course, as an ACC guy, I've got to root for the Tigers. But more importantly, it's not only critical now, but if they are fortunate enough to win, how do they move forward into the national championship game if those guys are unable to play? So, you know, and the task of possibly facing the Alabama defense without Kane, that could be really tough.
Dexter Miles Jr. picks up the personal. That's his first. Bob Huggins wants an explanation. You want to be on Bob's bad side this early in a game.
It's Huggy Bear. Huggy Bear doesn't have a bad side. Are you kidding me? I tell you what, I had a great time getting a chance to talk with him before the game. He's been one of the, you know, better coaches in college basketball for well over 30 years, and just a great guy to be around.
Down low to Williams off the glass, spins it home.
Good to see Devin Williams back on the court. Whatever the issue was, he's feeling fine and continuing to make his presence felt in the post.
How about this start for the Mountaineers, Corey? 6 of 11 from the field, a 10-point advantage already.
Well, we mentioned it. This is a good team, and then people will balk on their schedule and say they haven't really played a lot yet.
Williams, the and-one opportunity. Make that Devin Wilson the basket.
And that's where Devin Wilson has to continue to help the Virginia Tech Hokies. Only averaging over 3 points per game this year. This is a young man that I watched as a freshman have back-to-back games of 25 points and 20 points. Hasn't scored much since he's been playing for Buzz Williams, but he has to be more aggressive on the offensive end. He's good with the ball in his hands, and Coach Williams trusts him as a playmaker. But in college basketball today, you can't be a liability on the offensive end. You've got to be a threat to score the basketball.
Wilson to miss. Lidey the board. And a scrum on the deck. It'll stay with the Hokies. Zach Lidey getting after it.
But Lidey putting the ball on the floor, and Page was right there to pick his pocket. And that's one of the things in West Virginia, you can never feel comfortable. You can never feel at ease. And that's the way Bob Huggins wants for teams to feel when they play them. There's never a time that you can relax on the court. They always want to make sure that they're coming at you and that they're the type of team that wants to throw the first punch every time out.
Wilson will trigger. Pierce checks back in. It's 21 and white for the Hokies. More than 6 minutes in. Lidey. Well, that would have been a Sports Center top 10 highlight right there. Couldn't connect, but the foul is called. It'll go against Devin Williams, his first.
And a great design by Buzz Williams. Actually running a pick and roll, big to big. Zach Lidey, not the prototypical four man. So actually running the screen and roll with Pierce setting the screen. And seldom will you find a 4 and 5 understanding how to play pick and roll defense. That time, Williams and Holton getting caught up.
Lidey, not necessarily the most talented player on the floor, but he never gives up on any play.
And as you see, Pierce going up and setting the screen on Lidey. Very seldom will teams run their four-man with the ball in his hands and run a pick-and-roll with the five, but it is an advantage to be able to have a guy like Zach Lidey that can make plays off the dribble.
Transfer from South Florida, misses the second. Leading scorer and rebounder for Virginia Tech. Down low, attacking the rim, and down it goes. Jayshon Page out of nowhere. Seth Allen hammered him, Corey, but nothing going on there.
Page knows a three-point shooter, and because of his ability to stretch it from beyond the arc, the defense from Virginia Tech, two guys actually run out at him. But you see Page with that strong upper body more than capable of taking the contact and finishing with an opportunity for the three-point play.
Page, the best shooter for WVU. Bob Huggins wants him to attack the rim more. He did it there.
And there are very few teams that can do just that. West Virginia off a missed free throw, and they can even do it off of missed shots, can still establish their pressure. Early in the game, I said that, hey, you have to be able to score to be able to set up your pressure. Not for the Mountaineers. They can do it off of misses, and another turnover for Virginia Tech because of it.
Six turnovers now for Virginia Tech. It sounds like a West Virginia home game. The first sellout of the season here in Blacksburg. Daxter Miles Jr. And Williams can't finish. And an open look. Down it goes for Justin Bibbs. 62% from distance this year. Second in the country.
And if there's anyone on the court that should not get an open look from three, it is Justin Bibbs. And Bob Huggins is not going to be happy with his team on that one. That's in the scout report to make sure he doesn't get open looks.
Williams from 17 is off. Bibbs the board. Seth Allen. Oh, he had a path to the basket. Lost it out of bounds. A lot of blue and gold in this crowd here today in Blacksburg, Corey.
West Virginia is very well represented in this game, and you talked about it. This is an old rivalry. This goes back to, you know, well beyond these teams being in the Big 12 and the ACC. As a matter of fact, Bob Huggins had his career high versus Virginia Tech. 28 points in his junior year at West Virginia, 28 points against the Hokies. So this goes way, way back between these two schools.
They also told us he almost broke his ankle right under this basket that West Virginia's attacking right now. Two familiar foes. A rainbow baseline jumper way off. And over to Williams.
We mentioned the offensive rebounding prowess of the Mountaineers. 18 offensive boards a game. That's another offense. When you put together what they do off of turnovers, 29 points per game off turnovers, and then gathering 18 second chance opportunities, That is all about energy and effort. We talked to Bob Huggins about he really implemented this style back into play last year. This is the way his teams played in Cincinnati. He felt like he had to go out when he first got to West Virginia and get more skilled players because he heard about how they couldn't shoot and all the things they didn't do well. But now he has the type of players that really fit his personality. You see what they do. The balanced scoring for the Mountaineers. And you look at it, you know, Williams up front with the 16.1 points a game, but the perimeter players and what they're able to do, and a lot of that comes off of just taking the ball away and getting layups in transition.
You saw that graphic, and looking at Williams and Carter, Daxter Miles Jr., it reminds you of some of his old-school Cincinnati teams he had in the 1990s as Williams checks out.
Well, I know one, the 1993 team that knocked us out of the NCAA in the Sweet 16 with Nick Van Exel and Bostic and Corey Blunt. And, I mean, you know, you could go on for days and days. And Nick Van Exel and I actually were teammates in Denver for 3 years. And he reminded me about that game a lot.
Robinson double team. And draws the foul from Macon. 112 to play in our first half. West Virginia out to an 8-point advantage here inside of Castle Coliseum. Back in Blacksburg, two old rivals tangling today here inside of Castle Coliseum. Corey Alexander, Roy Philpott on hand. These two teams used to be back in the Big East. This is actually the 79th overall meeting between these two. And the West Virginia faithful making the quick trip over. Well, the state border can't be 50 miles away. It's very easy to get to Blacksburg. And you want to talk about the ACC versus the Big 12, Corey. We've been very impressed with the Big 12, really with both conferences, but the Big 12 in particular, including that colossal matchup coming up this weekend between KU and Oklahoma.
And the Big 12 has been very strong this year. And I actually heard, I won't take this for myself, Fran Priscilla say it last night. The Big 12 has 10 teams, which means that they have a true round robin. Everybody plays each other home and away. And I understand the economics and what's behind college basketball and conference alignment, but that has to be the best situation that you can have. The fact that if you go play a team and they beat you at their place, you have an opportunity to beat them back on your place. It's an even playing field, and it really gives you a true measure of how good that conference is from top to bottom.
Mountaineers already in the bonus. Virginia Tech basketball. Hokies trailing by 8. Tech has made 4 of its first 5 field goals, but West Virginia's already attempted 17 shots in this one. As the foul inside will go against Adrian.
And that's the most interesting number that you will see. I mean, when you think about it, and that's what West Virginia does. They're not a great shooting team, but they get so many more shots than their opponents. They have more shots than Virginia Tech on the season. They played one less game.
Allen in traffic with the finish and a little chimney afterwards.
Well, one thing about Buzz Williams and what he recruits, you know, they both like the same type of players. They want some guys with toughness that are going to go out and compete on every play. So Virginia Tech has those guys. The difference, Buzz Williams is in his second year at Virginia Tech. He doesn't have a full complement of roster of his type of player yet, where Bob Huggins has a full roster of his type of guy. But you mentioned this is a 10-year deal with this rivalry, and hopefully they renew it after that. This will be a great game in December for many years to come, the more Buzz Williams gets his type of talent on the court.
Issa Ahmad of the 1-1. The foul went against Justin Bibbs. Ahmad, a former ESPN top 100 player. Another big get by Bob Huggins and company. Well, he's got a veteran coaching staff. Larry Harrison and Ron Everhart, so much head coaching experience.
And of course, my guy Billy Hahn over there with Bob Huggins, who is an extension of what Bob Huggins is about.
Couldn't convert. And the foul will go against Zach Lodetti.
There's my guy, Billy Hahn. I tell you, when you want to talk about pressing and trapping style, Billy Hahn was an assistant coach at Maryland for 12 years, and you don't get any more fiery than this guy right here. He's not happy. And you see Coach Hahn having to turn his back. He doesn't want to pick up that technical foul on the bench, but you see there, right there at the back of Bob Huggins, the same way he was with Gary Williams for so long at the University of Maryland. And we talk about the style of play. Aggressive, trapping, pressing style is also part of Billy Hahn's DNA. Great assistant coach for Bob Huggins to have alongside him.
Dexter Miles Jr. at the stripe, 65% this season. Sophomore from Baltimore. Rattles that one out. Devon Carter comes up with a rebound, but it's called for the double dribble.
But another offensive rebound for West Virginia as they continue to get opportunities. We've got to keep an eye on Devin Williams. He sat out more in this half than you're normally expecting to see him. And making sure that hand is okay. He continues to favor that hand over on the bench.
Brandon Watkins checks in for the first time. That's 20 in blue. And working down low against Pierce. Bibbs tripped up. And a quick whistle.
And a great play by Justin Bibbs attacking the rim, and that's what you have to do against the pressure, especially in the half court against West Virginia. Because they get up on you, if you do not break that pressure and just go by guys with an attempt to score, they're not going to allow you to run your offense because they're in the passing lanes. You have to be able to beat guys one-on-one in order to be able to compete with the Mountaineers.
Foul went against Issa Amon, the freshman from Cleveland. He'll put Bibbs at the line. McCorry shoots 62% from three-point range, but just 52% from the free throw line this year. You explain that to me.
Mind-boggling. 58% from the field, 62 from three, and you go and you probably shoot worse at the free throw line than you do anywhere else. That is mind-boggling. I don't understand how a guy that shoots it that well with beautiful form can shoot that poorly at the free throw line.
Well, you mentioned Nick Van Exel earlier. You remember Nick used to take a couple of steps back from the charity stripe at the end of his NBA career.
You know where he got that from? I did the same thing, and we were teammates, and I told him to take a step back because we prided ourselves on being able to shoot with range. And so, you know, and I told him, I said, it's so hard for me to be able to shoot the free throws because you're used to shooting three-pointers from 24 feet. And so I always shot, again, I did it in San Antonio, so we got to Denver, and I was doing it. He said he was going to try it, and it worked out. Now, of course, I know him well enough to know he's not going to give me credit for that, but I got the microphone. You can't hear him right now, but I was the one who actually showed him to do that.
Well, I just learned something right there. Corey Alexander dropping some knowledge.
I'll tell you what, and regardless of what people felt his reputation was, Nick Van Exel was one of the best teammates I ever had. Was a great teammate. Was so much fun to be around. And, you know, there's very few guys that I'll say that were better than me, but he was better than me.
Out of bounds, here's the WVU turnover. Just the third of the first half. Lead is back to six. Bob Huggins, this will be his final non-conference tilt before they travel to Kansas State Saturday.
And, Roy, that goes back to a point that where you and I talked with Coach Huggins about before the game, where he says the team doesn't yet have that killer instinct. They will get up big on teams, but they don't bury them. Now, when you look at the numbers, they have almost tripled the field goal attempts that Virginia Tech has. But yet, Virginia Tech still within six, an opportunity to cut into the leading four. That shows us exactly what Coach Huggins was talking about, where his team needs to get that killer instinct.
Allen in traffic with the bounce this time. It's a four-point lead. And an offensive foul. Jonathan Holton picks up his second under the basket.
But what you've seen from Virginia Tech in the last few minutes is the attack off the dribble, trying to get to the rim and score. Because West Virginia is a great defensive three-point team. They're not going to give you easy looks from three. The number one in the country when it comes to guarding a three-pointer. You have to beat these guys off the dribble, break that pressure, and be able to finish at the rim.
Stoppage in play. They're going to reset the shot clock to 29 seconds. Roger Roger Ayers in mid-season form. I guess, honestly, we are at the middle part of the season right now, aren't
we? We're right there, but some conferences actually started play last night, so we're right there in the heart of what college football is all about.
Sweet dash, and Pierce down low converts. And here comes the crowd in Blacksburg. Second personal charge to Seth Allen.
And Seth Allen, of course, with a beautiful pass to Pierce under the basket on the previous possession. Now wants to pick up the intensity defensively. But in today's game, you can't put your hands on him on the perimeter. So because of that, Allen picks up his second foul and has to go sit down.
Williams also back to Bob Huggins' bench. Tariq Phillip at the stripe.
See Seth Allen with a beautiful pass against the pressure. Actually, it was Justin Robinson with the pass. But Justin with a beautiful pass underneath to Pierce, and it gets everyone up. You know, they start to get excited. Seth Allen a little too excited, pressing up at half court and getting his hands, of course, on the West Virginia players, able to knock down two free throws.
That'll stop a 6-0 Hokies run. And had the quickness advantage against Adrian. Eight on the shot clock. Pierce again wide open.
So what we're seeing is great ball movement by Virginia Tech and finding good looks under the rim because of the pressure of West Virginia on the perimeter defensively.
Another offensive rebound. Phillip for three. Back iron. And on the rebound attempt, the foul against Nathan Adrian is second.
Great adjustment by Buzz Williams. Now actually playing both his point guards on the floor. Devin Wilson as well as Justin Robinson. Both guys on the court. So therefore, when West Virginia presses and takes away one of the point guards, you can put the ball in the hands of another point guard who's been able to make plays. And Virginia Tech has now had some offensive success here recently because of the way they matched up on the offensive and defensive end.
Corey, you look at the stat sheet. Virginia Tech, 8 of 10 from the floor, but yet trails by 2, a chance to tie it at the stripe. Goes back to West Virginia's dominance on the glass, forcing turnovers and getting more shot opportunities. Mountaineers have already attempted 19 field goals in this one compared to just 10 for the Hokies.
But I believe Virginia Tech has figured out something, and of course it's simply going to be about making sure they take care of the basketball. But when they do, they know that they're going to have to get their points going to the rim. It's not going to be standing around and knocking down three-pointers. They're going to have to be in attack mode against this West Virginia defense.
Off the miss, it popped out to Miles. Way through the first half here in Castle Coliseum. Williams nearly traveled and throws it out of bounds.
And that's the second time that West Virginia has thrown the ball into the stands. So give Virginia Tech credit, defense credit. We've talked about West Virginia's defense, but give Virginia Tech credit on the defensive end. They've done the job here recently and slowed down West Virginia's offense.
You see the stat there. No field goals in the last 5-plus minutes for Bob Huggins' club. Credit the Hokies defensively for that number. And a scrum, Bibbs loses it to Page. Dexter Miles Jr. hangs and finishes. So physical, West Virginia in the backcourt. They can beat you in so many different ways. Here's another one.
And one thing you cannot do is reach for a loose ball against West Virginia. You have to get on the floor. And again, one of the best at turning defense and the offense as the Mountaineers lead by 4. Whether he's 6'9 or not, he's still a guard. But when you look at him, I mean, you look at Xavier Reddick with Dan Mays, We're not even sure he's the best player at Florida State right now. They've got two freshmen, Dwayne Bacon, who made the game winner for them yesterday against Florida, and Malik Beasley. They're both in the top 10 scoring in the ACC this year. Florida State is my dark horse team to have a great year in the ACC.
Well, you know they're going to defend under Leonard Hamilton, but you look at some of the firepower they have, and a big win yesterday against the rival. That's a nice little springboard into league play.
Especially going out on the road and getting it done.
Back to live action. The lead is 5 for WVU. Mountaineers at 10-1. Pierce in the paint. And the foul will go against the Hokies.
And that's not his strength. Pierce is an energy guy. Of course, great size and can finish around the rim. But Virginia Tech is not going to be successful in the offensive end if their mission is to throw the ball into Pierce against this West Virginia defense and allow and make him be the guy that's going to score. I understand breaking the pressure, getting the ball in the post, but that's the point where Devin Wilson, Justin Robinson, one of the point guards, someone has to go get the basketball and get them into an offensive set.
Now this is the guy to foul just 44% at the line, and of course is pure on the first.
He heard you say that, showing you his shooting touch.
It always works that way, doesn't it? There's some kind of psychological tie-in between the announcers and the free throw shooter in all levels of basketball.
Well, we have a number of guys in this game that you look at and, of course, are not great free throw shooters, but you will wonder why. We've already talked about Justin Bibbs, but then look at the numbers on Seth Allen. As good of a shooter as he is, not a great free throw shooter. So there's a lot of guys in here to kind of make you scratch your head and wonder what happened when they go to the free throw line.
Nice dish. Lede pinned at the rim and the foul called.
And another great attack by Devin Wilson. And that's the guy that you do want the ball in his hands, especially in the post area. Zach Lede knows how to score, very good around the basket. So a much better decision by Wilson that time, putting the ball in the hands of Lede.
Both teams in the double bonus. You see the numbers on Lede, 76% at the line for the season. Transfer from USF, actually has 7 double-doubles this season for the Hokies. And checking back in is Issa Ahmad.
He actually transferred up. Steve Rockerford, assistant coach for Virginia Tech, when he got the job coming with joining Coach Buzz Williams' staff. Zach Lede was not soon after that, you know, so of course you talk about relationship. Those two guys I'm sure had a great relationship at USF. And Lede was looking for a place to play once Dan Heath was let go. And Virginia Tech welcomed him with open arms, and he's paid off for them, having a great season so far for Coach Buzz Williams.
Token full court pressure now for Tech.
You see Virginia Tech now in the 2-3 zone. And this is where West Virginia could possibly struggle, having to shoot the ball from the perimeter against this 2-3. We'll see how they attack against it, try to find a way to still get in the perimeter.
Phillip in traffic, turns it over. And Bibbs travels. That was an awkward pass from Wilson. Turnover number 9 for Virginia Tech.
And it was just as you said, yeah, Devin Wilson pointing to himself saying, that's my fault, because as a point guard, he put Justin Bibbs in a very difficult situation. Really, whereas the point guard, he needs to keep the ball in his hands. You see now already 9 turnovers for Virginia Tech in the first half.
Well, Buzz Williams trying to do something to change the momentum here of this first 20 minutes. Operating now defensively out of a 2-3 zone. Devon Myers trying to feed Ahmad. Watches that pass out of bounds.
Yeah, but Myers has his hands up. Looking at Ahmad, that pass was hot. I mean, you're in close quarters to throw a basketball that hard at a guy who's actually moving and trying to run to the corner and expect for him to be able to catch that ball.
Hudson. Down low to Lede. No whistle. And it pops out to Myers.
That was a great no call by Roger Ayers, because Macon basically stood his ground. Lede was the one that created the contact, and you don't reward the offensive player for that.
How about that high-low action? Jonathan Holton to hoop on the feed from the top of the post.
And Jonathan Holton, of course, is a guy that can score. Averaged 10 points a game as a freshman at Rhode Island. Was an all-freshman team player. You see him creating space, and the beautiful high-low pass from Macon. Holton keeping it up high and being able to score, but more importantly, where Bob Huggins likes him is at the front of that press, as he, you know, he really initiates it, and that's what Huggins likes so much. Doesn't score the way that he did at Rhode Island, but he has a much stronger contribution to this team for what he does on the defensive end.
Foul call went against Tavon Myers, a junior from Brooklyn. That'll put Robinson at the line. Freshman averaging 6 points per game, converts on the first of two. Well, Virginia Tech hanging around here, not necessarily playing test basketball in the first 20 minutes. But I think if you're Buzz Williams, given where you are right now, you'll probably take this. You're in striking range here, Corey.
Well, and you can also go into halftime and make adjustments and clean up where you struggled, especially with the turnovers. But I think they found something by having the two point guards on the floor at the same time. They've been much better on the offensive end, especially attacking the rim.
Ladei called for the personal. Buzz Williams starting to get lathered up. He's ready.
Well, and then Ladei picking up his second foul now as Jalen Hudson coming into the game for Virginia Tech. But you look at Tech's lineup now, and you have four true guards on the court alongside Hamilton. So a smaller lineup for Virginia Tech. And if they're going to play the zone, they're going to have difficulty matching up with Holton and Macon really in that high-low.
Making two out of three so far at the strike this afternoon. Hudson back in. Ladei to the bench for Buzz Williams. We mentioned conference play heats up for both of these squads this weekend. West Virginia will leave straight from Blacksburg and head over to Manhattan, Kansas to face the Wildcats. Meanwhile, Virginia Tech will get NC State here Saturday as well, but this one kind of feels like a conference game, the physicality with what we've seen so far.
It really does, and we mentioned this is a rivalry game, an old rivalry game, and with so many West Virginia fans being in the building here today, it does feel like one of those conference games because you've got people cheering on both sides of the floor.
Mountaineers have led by as many as 10. Ladei, a patient move but can't finish, a wild shot. Beautiful cut, and inside is Jayshon Page. West Virginia now with its largest lead once again, call it 10 and a timeout on the floor with 5:39 remaining. Buzz Williams wants to talk things over. A good timeout here. Mountaineers with all the momentum. Boy.
It was. And West Virginia continuing to attack inside the paint. As you see Page with the beautiful cut and getting face cut. Devin Wilson. Buzz Williams was not happy with Justin Bibbs on that. But it's Devin Wilson who actually got face cut. And that's one of the cardinal sins in the game of basketball that you cannot allow to happen. We see Coach Williams in his huddle not very happy with his team right now, simply because of what they've done on the defensive end of the floor.
I don't think he was telling them happy holidays.
Well, I mean, you know, I'm sure Coach Williams is in the holiday season, but for him, it's just not the time right now to discuss that.
10-2 run for the Mountaineers. Don't forget, Virginia Tech had a chance to tie it at the line. Wilson missed the front end of a 1-1. And since then, WVU has taken this one over.
And West Virginia really doing it without their starters right now. Williams has been silent. Carter hasn't had a huge game.
Boy, the whistle could have been blown there. Macon collided with Ladei midair. No whistle. It'll stay with the Hokies. Boy, this game has been ultra physical.
Well, one thing you and I both know is when West Virginia was on the schedule, it was going to be physical. I don't care who they play, it's going to be physical. But Virginia Tech wants to play the same style. They want to be physical. And I mentioned it before, I don't think that right now Buzz Williams has his full complement of his type of player yet. He has more of them infused in the lineup right now than he did last year. But as he continues to go, this game is going to be one of the more physical games that you'll see in college basketball each year as this rivalry continues.
25 total free throws already attempted. We're not even 15 minutes into this one.
And this does not have anything to do with the new directors. This is simply about there are fouls going on the court here today.
Baseline, Trey, count it, Jayshon Page. Well, he's their best three-point shooter. He shows you why there, and there's an offensive foul. Seth Allen picks up his third personal.
And that's always the danger of putting one of your guys back on the court with two fouls. Especially if we talked about the physical nature of this game. Now Seth Allen will be much less aggressive in the second half because of what's happened here in the first.
He checked for Page. Back iron and controlled by Justin Robinson. Now Page fouls Robinson from behind.
And Seth Allen, the second leading scorer for Virginia Tech, now having to watch with his third personal. And it doesn't just affect you right now for the remaining 5:06 of the first half. It's more important in the second half. He probably can't start the second half now, and you can only use him in spots because it's so difficult to ask a guy to get fouled in the first half not to get in foul trouble in the second half and not get any because he's only 2 fouls away from being disqualified in this game.
Allen, the transfer from Maryland. You see the numbers on Robinson. Devin Williams also checks back in for the Mountaineers.
And if you, when you mention Maryland, a true basketball fan can't think of any other example of physical pressure basketball than what Bob Huggins and the Mountaineers did to Maryland in the NCAA tournament last year.
Remember it very well. Here's a steal. Robinson, coast to coast.
And that's the one thing about West Virginia. They will turn it over themselves. Even though they force more turnovers than anyone, they give you opportunities by turning the basketball over themselves on the offensive end.
Yeah, there's an Iowa State component to the Mountaineers. Iowa State will get up to a big lead and then give it right back. West Virginia's done that at times this year so far, too. Williams down low, nearly traveled, and gets it to go. Williams now with 8.
And he's pretty much just Mr. All Reliable on the court for Bob Huggins. Whenever you're in trouble, get the ball to the hands of Devin Williams, your best player. Normally good things happen.
Mountaineers blew out Virginia Tech in Morgantown a year ago. Virginia Tech won on this court 2 seasons ago. Sweet crossover, Hudson off the glass.
And that's Jalen Hudson's game, attacking the rim. He did that for 32 points in the ACC tournament opening last year as a freshman. And he's a guy that really has to continue to pick up his production, especially with Chris Clark out with injury. The Hokies are going to need much more production from Jalen Hudson.
Myers for 3. Robinson the rebound. And trying to split the double team, he'll travel.
Justin Robinson with nowhere to go, but if you're West Virginia, there's always a place to go. Right inside to Devin Williams as he gives the team the 10-point lead.
Dino, Anish, thank you very much. With Corey Alexander, Roy Philpott. Buzz Williams in year number 2. It's going to take some time, but he's already showing signs of really revamping this Virginia Tech program.
They are. It's simply about the way they go about playing. We talked about the identity that the West Virginia Mountaineers have and their style of play. Buzz Williams was known for a very similar style of play at Marquette. We talked about these two teams, well, these two coaches being old Big East rivals, and now Buzz Williams trying to implement that style here in Blacksburg, and he's done a great job recruiting the state of Virginia in the 2 years that he's been here. 5 players on the team already from the state, and pretty much all those guys he brought in his time here. Chris Clark, of course, probably the most heralded of those recruits, as well as bringing Seth Allen, the transfer from Maryland. They fit what he wants to be able to do. We look at the breakdown as to where the guys are, but I mean, we also have to look at Ohio, Justin Bibb from Ohio. You know, he's been able to recruit nationally, but still, we're getting in the state always helps coming into a new job.
In traffic, offensive foul. So Jay Sean Page, a bit too aggressive. That's his second personal.
A great job by Justin Bibb getting over and getting his body into position. And Justin Bibbs, of course, was recruited by James Johnson, the previous coach, coming in. So Buzz Williams did not recruit Justin Bibbs, but Bibbs has started to try to take on the identity of what is necessary to play for Buzz Williams, and that's it. We looked at a guy who is shooting over 60% from three, but you have to do the intangibles to play for Buzz Williams. It's not necessarily about what looks good. It's about how hard you play and especially getting the job done on the defensive end, and Bibbs is starting to fit into that role.
Now, he said this week, he reiterated, Corey, that he doesn't necessarily have a starting five. He wants to see how you finish. It's not how you begin these games. And very versatile in how he deals with his players game in and game out. And foul inside. Johnny Hamilton picks up the personal, his second.
And you mentioned that with Buzz Williams. It's simply about you have to prove yourself every day
right
with him. It's not about, hey, these are our starters, we're going to stick with this lineup. You got to prove yourself time in and time out. Where the opposite for Bob Huggins, he's used the same starting lineup the entire year, but we've seen in stretches of this game really where they've increased the lead, he didn't have one starter on the floor, maybe Halton, but he pretty much had all reserves on the floor throughout that entire time.
That's an air ball at the strike, and that's not good.
You couldn't have put that any better. You know, I normally am talking during free throws. I'm normally talking all the time, but I'm definitely normally talking during free throws. And when that happens, it kind of catches my attention. I was going to let it go. But you could not have explained that any better, my friend.
Short and sweet. Yeah, you can't let that one go. Under three to play. The lead is back to 11. And a five-second violation. Hokies turn it over. That's number 13.
And that is now three separate occasions where the Hokies have not been able to get the ball in bounds versus this West Virginia offense. I'm sorry, West Virginia defense. And not to include the number of offensive fouls Virginia Tech has gotten by pushing players off trying to get open. So the pressure for West Virginia has been significant here today.
Leading the country in steals coming into today's game, also in turnovers force. It's what they do. Carter against Wilson, 14 on the shot clock. And the chippy go against Justin Robinson, his second. Well, we've seen the physical play down low, Corey, and we've seen also, well, some silly fouls out of the perimeter at times in this first half.
We have, and Virginia Tech, of course, it really doesn't have the same level of depth that West Virginia has made those fouls, especially when you're fouling guys, you know, 25, 30 feet away from the basket, just putting the ball on the floor, running their offense. They need to be able to keep their players on the floor. You can't pick up those fouls, but more importantly, put West Virginia at the free throw line with opportunities to score without having to work hard on the offensive end to do it.
Phillips, a junior out of Brooklyn. West Virginia now 11 of 15 at the free throw line. And gets the second.
I'm still trying to wipe the grin off my face and stop laughing about your air ball comment.
Well, I mean, it is what it is. Foul the inbounds pass. This one getting rather chippy, rather quickly, as Myers picks up his second. Both teams a double bonus. The lead is 12. And for Virginia Tech, you got to find a way to be more productive at the line. You're 7 of 14 so far, Corey.
And this is not a very good free throw shooting team when you start talking about the Hokies. Only 65% as a team. And more important, they have guards that don't shoot the ball well from the free throw line. Justin Robinson, one of their better free throw shooters. So fortunately, he's the guy getting the opportunity to go there. But 65% as a team makes it difficult to win, especially when you're not a great shooting team or a great ball handling team.
Both teams shooting the basketball relatively well. Robinson bangs home the second. Back to a 2-point advantage for the Mountaineers. An important 2.5-minute stretch for Virginia Tech to get into the locker room, the single-digit deficit perhaps. And here's another foul. This one will go against WVU. That's Phillip.
Well, and we've seen West Virginia will let you get back into the game. So a turnover there with the opportunity for Virginia Tech to get this lead under 10. And you're absolutely right. 2.5 minutes to get some momentum going into the second half that could try to carry you into a win here at home.
No-look dish. In and out. The offensive rebound and the putback. Shane Henry, his first basket.
And Shane Henry, who started the majority of the year, getting his first action here, but a lot of it has to do with the fact that Virginia Tech has so many guys in foul trouble. Buzz Williams having to go even deeper into the bench, but Shane Henry coming up with the big basket for the Hokies.
Started his first six games, now coming off the bench. Don't forget about Super Tuesday on ESPN, presented by Hotels.com. It should be a super game. We've got the best freshman in college basketball. He is Ben Simmons. He can do pretty much everything, leading LSU against number 10 Kentucky at 9 Eastern. You can also catch it streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app. LSU, supremely talented. Lost at home to Wake Forest last night. It's been kind of a difficult start, despite the fact that Simmons has played so well.
Well, the thing is, they're supremely talented, but the pieces don't always mesh that very, very well. And the one thing about Ben Simmons, and, you know, people will mistake my comments about him as saying that I don't like him. I think Ben Simmons is an unbelievable talent. But he struggles to shoot the basketball. And in college basketball, if you can't attack from the perimeter, teams will allow you to score the paint all day as long as they can, as long as they make threes. So therefore, you know, LSU is not a very good shooting team right now, and that's really where they struggle, and they're not a great defensive team to stop the other team.
Hudson for three on the bounce. And the Hokies right back in it, trailing only by six with 90 seconds remaining in the first half.
And you mentioned that ever-important two-and-a-half-minute stretch. If the Hokies can continue to build momentum, it puts them in great shape for the second half.
Myers is stripped. Here comes Virginia Tech. And Wilson will set up the offense. The high ball screen, nothing doing. Dangerous pass and a late whistle, the bailout. Boy, Henry was trying to establish himself, had to reach for the pass, and Ahmad fouled him.
The line for your Hokies, number zero, Shane Henry.
Two old rivals meeting for the 79th time today, and West Virginia is led by as many as 13. Hokies trying to scratch and claw their way back in it. I don't have anything to say with that one.
I was waiting. I wanted to see how you were going to describe that.
It went, but it was ugly. And Henry converts one of two. The lead is five under a minute to play. Back in it. Well, Carter wanted that one. Carter in the paint with the finish. And the end one opportunity coming for Javon Carter.
Javon Carter plays as though he's much more experienced, only a sophomore. But you mentioned it, he really wanted to take that first three, but he knew it was not the time or the shot in the right situation for a team. He got the ball in the hands of Devin Williams, and because Devin Williams takes so much attention from the opposing team's defense, gets it back and does a great job attacking the rim instead of settling for a jump shot. That is a veteran play by Javon Carter, only a sophomore, but playing well beyond his years here for Coach Bob Huggins at the point guard position.
Bob doesn't mind him shooting the three, but I think he heard his coach in his ear on the shot fake and said, you know what, I better attack the rim.
I'm sure he's been there before. He's taken that shot and got a bit of a tongue lash on the sidelines for it.
A big three-point play for Javon Carter, the Mountaineers, and the lead is back to eight.
And the momentum had swung to Virginia Tech, but that three-point play now gives West Virginia a bit more breathing room as they near the end of the half.
7 second difference between the game clock and the shot clock. And Henry a bit uncomfortable. Free throw line extended. Seven to shoot. And Wilson has it stripped by Phillip. Three on two. Plenty of time, and Phillip gets it to go. And a heave from half court is too strong. Our halftime score, 46 to 36, the Mountaineers. shooting 54% in the first half. You see the turnovers. Two old rivals tangling here inside of Castle Coliseum. An exciting first 20 minutes in the books. Let's send you down to the studio with Anish Shroff and Dino Gaudio. Guys, WVU with a 10-point advantage. And hi, everybody, with Corey Alexander, Roy Philpott. An exciting first 20 minutes. It was a foul fest at times, Corey. But Devin Williams getting the job done. 9 points, 4 rebounds, and West Virginia's pressure also very effective.
Absolutely. West Virginia's pressure really was the story of the first half. Virginia Tech did a very good job weathering the storm later in the first half, getting to the rim. However, they have Seth Allen in foul trouble. A number of guys picked up multiple fouls for Virginia Tech. Can they continue to perform when they have so many guys in foul trouble? You look, Jalen Hudson and Justin Robinson both giving a big lift to the Hokies in the first half, but they're going to need back today and Seth Allen to have productive second half to be successful.
What you love about Williams, he never forces it. He's got the outside jumper out to 17 feet, but you see the basket so close to the rim.
And oftentimes the ones close to the rim are the ones that he goes and gets off offensive rebounds. He is so dominant on the offensive glass. And that makes it, that's just another dimension to what he does in the game. It's so much pressure he puts on the opposing team's defense.
I'll tell you what, too, Bob Huggins talked about the toughness of this team and whether or not he would have a player this year that could give him that component. Williams was banged up early in the first half, responded late, and the early three-pointer here for Javon Carter.
And Javon Carter didn't have a big offensive first half, picked up foul trouble early, but starts out the second half, you know, really doing what he provides for this West Virginia team. He's a big shot maker. Made a big shot at the end of the first half to give them a little more separation, and then a huge three to start off the second.
Back to the largest lead of the contest for the Mountaineers. And Bibbs, a rare miss from distance. Carter clears. Isamad down low.
You know, and I'll give the officials a lot of credit because there have been a lot of fouls called in this game, but there could have been so many more, and they really could have had this game bogged down, but they've done a good job balancing between allowing these guys to play and then keeping them under control and making sure they control the game.
Pressure force, 14 first half turnovers for Virginia Tech.
With an inadvertent horn.
Well, we saw an air ball and a free throw attempt in the first half. We saw another one that was banked in, and here we've got the inadvertent horn as the clock stopped running. So not sure what's going on there. Our veteran officiating crew led by Roger Ayers, Tim Comer, will talk things over. And another brief delay here in Blacksburg.
It just gives us more and more time to talk. You know we love that.
So the clock stopped by accident. They put 10 seconds back on the clock in the first 20 minutes. The same issue occurred, and they'll add some more time back here. Ryan O'Connell, our third member of our officiating crew. Well, they're all over today. That's all you can ask for, Corey.
Yeah, absolutely. But in the time that we have had, we've seen West Virginia come out and already on a 5-0 run to start the second half to increase their lead to 15 points. It's dangerous territory for the Hokies right now. You don't have Seth Allen on the floor because he picked up his third foul at the end of the first half. So, therefore, he did not start the second half. And he is one of your primary scorers alongside of Zach LaDay. They've got to find some offensive production because they can. I believe that the Hokies can do a good job defensively against West Virginia if they don't turn the basketball over and give them opportunities to get out in transition for easy buckets.
Reset the clock to 18:42. Don't forget Houston at USF as soon as we're done today. Rob Gray, the leading scorer in the American Conference, taken to the court in Tampa. That'll be the second of 6 games on ESPNU on this New Year's Eve Eve.
How about the schedule, the upcoming schedule for Virginia Tech? They have 3 games in 5 days. They play a ranked West Virginia team. They have to play play NC State, and then they come back and play University of Virginia, ranked number 5 in the country right now. And not to mention the fact that they have to play Duke right after that. So, you know, not an easy task to start off conference play for Buzz Williams and his team, and definitely not an easy task in their final non-conference game against the Mountaineers.
Pierce trying to feed LaDay down low, and a shot clock violation, another turnover, 15 now. For Tech, and there you see the schedule. Well, the ACC rough and rugged, just like the Big 12.
It really is. You know, the ACC, in my opinion, probably the best conference in college basketball, but more so top heavy than when you look at the Big 10 and especially the Big 12. But when you're going to face already five teams ranked in ACC right now, and with Pittsburgh right there on the outside. So you're looking at a tough conference slate for everybody coming through, which makes college basketball season so much fun.
Down low to Devin Williams. That foul on the floor. Pierce picks up his third.
And you made a statement, you know, off air at halftime about Devin Williams, where, you know, he doesn't score his points in a loud manner. He's not bravado, beating his chest, doing any of that. So you don't really know, but when you look at the stat sheets and you see in the first half, he's already halfway to another double-double. He just goes about doing his business quietly. But, of course, the toughness is always there.
Holton in traffic and a blocking foul. That'll go against the Hokies as Shane Henry picks up his second.
Easy call for Tim Coleman there. Shane Henry his feet on the restricted area mark. So, you know, it's an automatic block. You don't have to worry about there being any boos in the crowd. And a great job by the crowd. Knowledgeable, understanding that he's within the restricted area. It's going to be a charge. Don't even bother booing the officials. As Holton attacks the rim, and you see Henry well inside the restricted area. And I believe that makes it much easier for the officials not having to worry about that judgment call.
That real estate, of course, pushed out a solid 12 inches this year to increase the freedom of movement, reduce physicality. The directives as mandated by the NCAA to see if scoring and the number of possessions can go up as part of 25 different rule changes this year as well. And it's been very effective. Here's another steal and down low. The miss. Holton. Puts it in.
But a miss, free throw, into pressure, and a turnover, two offensive rebounds, and a basket. That is West Virginia basketball.
He'll break the pressure this time. This is Wilson into paint off the glass.
And great decision by Devin Wilson, not trying to overpass, but staying on attack. No one ever picked him up, and he was able to finish at the rim.
Wilson now with four, Mountaineers basketball. WVU 10-1 coming into this, win their final nine conference game of the year. Now that is until the SEC Big 12 Challenge. You forget this year, they moved that to the end of January. Carter, high off the glass.
Carter continues to be aggressive, attacking the rim. Now after knocking down a three-pointer here in the second half.
Ladei stripped, but hacked.
And West Virginia continues to move the basketball side to side, but Carter, after knocking down a three-pointer in the first possession of the second half, now Justin Robinson has to respect that. Carter does a great job putting the ball on the floor, and more importantly, not picking up the charge, but using the glass for the easy floater.
Perfect from the field, the only player in this game in double figures with 12. You think about Javon Carter, you think about defense. If he's giving you that kind of production consistently, especially as conference play gets underway later next month, West Virginia's going to be that much more difficult to beat.
Yeah, and he's done a very good job of really not even forcing the action. He's taken good shots, you know, here during this game and really ran the offense the way that Coach Huggins needs for him to. I mean, but again, they have a lot of depth in the backcourt. They have depth in the frontcourt. This is one of the deeper teams that you'll see in college basketball. And Coach Huggins, more importantly, trusts, you know, the 10 to 11 guys he's going to play every time out. That's one thing that's really special about the team, because very few coaches have that amount of trust in their entire roster.
After some full court pressure, Hokies will trickle back into their zone. Nine to shoot. Miles Jr. for three. In and out. And a putback.
And if you look at just what Macon has done today, when Williams has been on the bench, you're not going to find a lot of teams that have that level up front. And then you throw Holton into the mix, and what he does with the pressure. The West Virginia fans may be outnumbering the Hokie fans here today, but they are extremely happy of the way their Mountaineers have performed out to a 20-point lead.
And the Cotton Bowl Classic coming up at 8 p.m. Eastern. 20-point lead for number 19, West Virginia. Corey Alexander, Roy Philpott, and the Mountaineers' full-court pressure really starting to take its toll.
And Daxter Miles Jr. getting in, knocking the basketball away right to Holton. And the West Virginia pressure, and you mentioned it before, Bob Huggins loves Holton at the front of the press. But when you have guards that are so good on the defensive end, that pressure, I mean, out of a timeout, they come up with another turnover. and add points. They had 15 points off of 11 turnovers in the first half. And already in the second half, we've seen West Virginia lock in defensively.
Now, Javon Carter set the freshman record for steals in the Big 12 last year.
But it's so many guys that get involved in it. When you look at this West Virginia team, they have, you know, double-digit players that have steals. They have six players that average over one steal a game, three players average over two steals a game. Most teams don't have one player on their roster that averages two steals per game. They've got three. But then you've got so many more averaging over one steal a game. I mean, it's almost, you know, unrealistic the way that they pressure. And you look at the way they line up. They dare you to throw the ball over top of them because they know if you do beat them, they're behind you with the back tip, which puts even more pressure on you.
And, Corey, the other thing that's so impressive is Bob Huggins will change how that pressure works. They'll trap. They'll do a lot of different things to try to confuse you later on as Justin Robinson attacks the rim and draws the contact.
And the example of that was simply the last possessions. That was coming out of a timeout. Buzz Williams drew up what he wanted his team to do out of the timeout, how they were going to go about breaking the pressure. But it wasn't the man-to-man. Now it was the diamond 1-2-1-1 pressure, which ends up being, you know, two more turnovers for Virginia Tech just trying to inbound the basketball.
And the Mountaineers in the midst of a 15-3 run to create some separation here at the start of the second half. Robinson already at his season average. Misses a pair. Hokies facing their largest deficit. LeDay's been very quiet in foul trouble. Comes up short, bothered by Macon, who brings on the rebound. Now the Mountaineers will work on that half-court offense. Skip pass to Adrian. Cleared by Lede. Sellout crowd sitting on its hands as West Virginia and its fan base has sucked the life right out of Castle Coliseum.
You know, if you're Virginia Tech, and I understand wanting to run good offense, and a part of the West Virginia defense is designed to make you take quick shots, but when you get wide open looks, you may need to take them early in the shot clock because, one, you've got to make up some ground, but more importantly, you may not get a better shot against this West Virginia defense.
5 minutes into the second half, it's all Mountaineers here in Blacksburg.
Who's gonna be the one?
Tune up before conference play gets underway this coming Saturday, both in the ACC and in the Big 12. West Virginia leading 61-39. Back in Blacksburg, Corey Alexander, Roy Philpott courtside. It's been an entertaining start to this one. West Virginia starting to create some separation. The Mountaineers, Corey, pick six in the rough and rugged Big 12. And I'm telling you right now, they're a lot better than what the preseason prognosticators were thinking back in October.
Well, when I look at the poll and I see Texas and Baylor ahead of West Virginia, you know, and I understand why people would say it, but I have, you know, I live in Richmond, Virginia, and I've had so many people ask me, do you think Shaka Smart's style of play, the way that he played at BCU, would work at Texas? And my question to them was, have you seen West Virginia? Because Bob Huggins has already done it in the Big 12. This is, you know, it was a battle between those two teams last year, BCU and West Virginia, who would lead the league in steals and lead the country in steals. And you see West Virginia, what they continue to do as well as here today, they turn you over. Shaka Smart can play that style at Texas, but he's going to have to recruit the personnel there to do it the way that Bob Huggins has done it in Morgantown.
Well, they're already playing at a decent level. Setting North Carolina earlier on a last-second tip-in. UT lost to UConn last night in Austin. Bob Carter's had the hot hand. hand down low, and that continues now with 16.
And what Carter gives them is a consistent perimeter threat, not necessarily shooting the basketball, but a guy that they can depend upon to go out and get them, you know, 12 points a game, and allows it to take some pressure off of Williams.
Henry with the flush. What does Virginia Tech have to do to make this one more respectable, perhaps have a chance to get back in it, Corey?
Well, they're going to need more plays like that where they're able to be able to attack the pressure. And the thing for Virginia Tech is when you break the pressure getting across half court, you have to take advantage of West Virginia's aggressiveness. You probably can't pull the ball back out at that point and run offense because you allow their defense to catch back up. You got to take advantage of your 2-on-1s and 3-on-2 situations, but you got to score as well.
Oh, Carter feeling it. And with the bounce, 18 points, a perfect 8-for-8 from the field for Javon Carter. What a game he is having. Remember the All-Big 12 defensive team a year ago, making his case on the offensive side here today.
And just as West Virginia continues to pile it on, they bring in their starting front court, sitting over there waiting to get their chance as Dax Miles, the second leading scorer on this team, gets out into transition.
Daxter Miles Jr., double figures in 16 of his last 19 contests, and on his way once again this afternoon. Henry Hack from behind. Now, don't forget about Big Monday. It's the first Big Monday of the season on ESPN. First at 7. It's number 7 UNC battling Florida State in their freshman combo of Bacon and Beasley. And then we're at Allen Fieldhouse, where Buddy Hield and the third-ranked Sooners face Perry Ellis and number 2 KU. In a journey to the tourney matchup, both games streaming live on Watch ESPN and, of course, on the ESPN app, which Gray Alexander just downloaded a few moments ago.
Absolutely, and of course, there's a lot of basketball to be played before Big Monday. However, with those games, Kansas and Oklahoma could be a number 1 versus number 2 matchup on Monday night if they both are able to win this weekend. With Michigan State losing, you would think that those two teams move up as long as they're able to survive their Saturday games, but I believe it's Oklahoma that's playing Iowa State. So, of course, that's going to be a tough task for them. But, again, in the Big 12, conference play, it doesn't matter. It's always going to be a competitive game because there's so much familiarity between the programs.
Henry inside. And an and-one opportunity coming from the senior from Decatur, Georgia.
And again, almost another turnover for West Virginia, but this time the fortunate bounce goes right into the hands of Shane Henry, the pump fake, and the opportunity for and one. Shane Henry's really given the Hokies a big lift at the end of the first half and here in the second half as well.
Henry with 7 second half points. Now in double figures with 10 overall. 21-point advantage, and Henry this time called for the hack over the back, his third. Well, you mentioned Michigan State, of course, the upset last night at Iowa. Our thoughts and prayers with Tom Izzo and the Michigan State family, the passing of his father earlier this week.
And Michigan State, of course, also playing without, you know, Denzel Valentine, who could very well be the National Player of the Year. So I don't think anyone would have expected, honestly, for Michigan State to win that game last night going in Iowa. It pretty much would have been, you know, a heroic effort if they had.
Traveling against Holton. He'll turn it over. Bob Huggins still coaching. He's not going to back off at all.
Love watching that guy on the sideline and get an opportunity to talk to him. We were sharing stories before the game talking to you about it. I actually played for Bob Huggins in the USA basketball trials. And, you know, whenever a coach comes in and he had myself and Jalen Rhodes and, you know, D.C. legend Kurt Smith and the three of us on his team, and he told all the big guys, get these three guys the ball and get out of the way. Just like Devin Williams chose to get out of the way with Shane Henry coming to the rim right there.
Shane Henry now with 12 points and providing a spark off of Buzz Williams' bench. 8 minutes into the second half, Hokies trying to get back in it. Henry has scored the last 9, Corey.
And the way to go about it is you have to attack. When you break the pressure, this time Justin Bibbs doing a great job putting it on the floor, and Shane Henry puts it through the rim.
Boom! West Virginia is shooting a blistering 72% from the field in the second half, and Javon Carter remains perfect.
And we've talked about his defense, but it's been his offense at the forefront today. Javon Carter continues to attack the basket and, more importantly, taking great shots, finding the right time to knock down the three-pointer, but has been attacking off the dribble, getting to the rim, and finding opportunities that's really set him apart. Here this afternoon, Javon Carter, of course, coming from Proviso East High School, same high school as one of my mentors and one of my teammates when I first went into the league, Doc Rivers. And the defensive effort is very similar to the way that Doc used to get it done on the defensive end.
You're just dropping knowledge everywhere today.
I'm hanging out with you. I had to bring out some of my best stuff today.
Corey Alexander, the reason Nick Van Exel shoots longer free throws than just about anybody else. Who knew? Three-pointers off. Phillip with the offensive rebound. Carter has to force it. And his first miss of the afternoon. The foul inside.
That's a horrible way to have to get your first miss. Shooting a crazily contested shot at the end of the shot clock. He's really a team guy, because I might have had to hold that one until the shot clock went off.
Now, see, I remember you from your days in the ACC and in the NBA. I always thought of you as a guy that didn't mind sharing the basketball, that was thinking team first. I'm picking up on a different sense here today as we look at these numbers.
Hey, I pass when they double-team me. I was a great passer out of the double team. One-on-one, forget it. It's going up.
You were Kobe Bryant.
We look at these two guys today and what they've done. Of course, we were expecting it from Carter, but Shane Henry, really a huge boost. Off the bench for Virginia Tech, Justin Bibbs actually out of the game right now, has played the entire game and was cramping up. And that's part of what this West Virginia pressure will do. It will wear you down. I mean, again, it's not like you're just basically walking the ball up half court. It's almost like being in a boxing match and, you know, a 15-round heavyweight fight to play against the Mountaineers.
Wilson slices baseline. We'll send it out to Robinson, who's blocked out of bounds by Holton. There you see Bibbs cramping up. You can't cramp up before conference play gets here, can you?
Well, when you play against West Virginia and you don't have a sub, and that's what brings it on. I mean, it's not about, hey, just we're going to run down and run our offense. There's a fight to get just across half court, let alone be able to get anything done on the offensive end. And then you've got to go out and guard guys like Carter.
Contact on the inbounds pass, and Holden hits the deck. Appears to be okay. Well, for a moment he was wincing in pain. You see him doing that again, and now we'll call to come out.
And you see that left shoulder as he reaches in. That does not look good. When you immediately go for that shoulder, and the shoulder already bandaged up. Don't want to speculate, but you hate seeing any of that go on.
Hudson in the paint. Another quick whistle working against Phillip.
If anyone's ever had an issue with their shoulder, you know that that's very uncomfortable. I dislocated mine once, and I've had a lot of injuries. But on impact, that one may hurt more than anything. And you're sleeping, you have to sleep sitting up. I mean, it hurts to breathe when you do something to your shoulder.
How long does it take for it to heal when that happened to you?
Unfortunately, I was in Italy when I did it, and they wanted me to continue playing, so they told me it was a bruise.
Ouch.
And when I finally got back to the States 2.5 months later, I was told that I had a grade 2 separation. By the way, I had to go back and play in Europe after that.
Good for you. Smart decision. Now, Holton continuing to be tended to on the West Virginia bench. Devin Williams was banged up in the early stages of this one, but appears to be okay. Phillip against Lede, blocked. Nice defense. And then hacked from behind. Phillip picks up his third.
And Lede doing a great job, as you mentioned, on the defensive end, coming up with the block shot. Actually had a career high 4 block shots in their last game out against St. Joe's. The wingspan of Zach Lede allowing him, only goes about 6'7", but you see the long arms, and allowing him to be a significant shot blocker on the interior for the Hokies.
Yeah, leading scorer, rebounder, and also shot blocker with 17 rejections this year. All those pacing the Hokies. Virginia Tech coming in at 8-4. Hokies in the 1-1, and now the bonus coming for Lede.
Good to see Holton back on the court. And he's already got that left shoulder bandage. You see him shaking it out over there, so there's probably already been an issue. Hopefully just a minor re-aggravation of that, nothing major, but always good seeing guys when they get back on the court, especially after going off in pain.
Well, Virginia Tech trying to get back into it, trailing now by just 16. Hokies need a couple of stops. Mountaineers in their motion offense. Dexter Miles Jr. down low. Out to Carter. A rare miss. And controlled by Jayshon Page. Fouled by Shane Henry.
And Carter, of course, upset because he missed what was almost a point-blank layup, one of the easier shots he's had on the day. And you see what threw him off. He shouldn't have shot that one at the end of the shot clock. See, you know how when it only takes one to get you hot, it only takes one to throw you off, too, and that one might have thrown him off.
And now that basket's about the size of a dime, where he was standing on the beach, throwing it in the ocean earlier.
Hey, don't move, baby.
At last, foul correction, not against Henry, but actually on Devin Wilson, his first. Ayers again with the calls. Dexter Miles Jr. sky for the rebound. Third against Jalen Hudson.
And that's where West Virginia again is so good. It's not just Williams on the offensive board. You see Dexter Miles getting involved. And part of the reason for West Virginia why they're so good in the offensive glass, their guards don't get back on defense because they pick you up full court. So therefore, they're not running back trying to get out of the play. They're staying up.
Halfway through the second half, here's Miles Jr. With a whipping around the horn, Jayshon Page. Mm-hmm. 11 points now for Jayshon Page, the top three-point shooter for WVU. And Hudson attacking the rim, foul. Will shoot two. As Devin Williams picks up his third.
And Virginia Tech doing a good job attacking, and that's what we were talking about before. When you break the pressure, you get across half court against West Virginia, you can't allow them to run back and set their defense. You have to take advantage of those opportunities, whether it's a 3-on-2 or 2-on-1, and try to get to the rim. Hudson unable to finish on the layup, but gets to the free throw line, able to knock on the first. But that's the only way West Virginia is going to give you opportunities, and if you don't take advantage of them, you're going to struggle to score against the Mountaineers.
Lone loss for WVU this year came against top 10 Virginia. Mountaineers at 10-1 coming in, trying to win their 11th contest before Big 12 play starts at Kansas State on Saturday.
And in that game against Virginia, the first half was all West Virginia. They controlled the tempo, the pace, the way they wanted to play. But in the second half, it was Virginia doing just what we were talking about. When they broke the pressure, they were able to get out and score points off of it. And West Virginia themselves had 18 turnovers in that game, which ended up hurting them, giving Virginia too many easy looks.
Two on the shot clock, Page. The finger roll can't connect. Holton and Macon banging down low. Another quick whistle. And Zach Lede will pick up his third.
I love how Bob Huggins told us before, and I asked him, I said, Coach, okay, you guys lead the country in so many statistical categories last year. Why was last year different? And he basically said, I went back to playing the way that we played at Cincinnati, as well as I went back to getting the personnel similar to the way that they had at Cincinnati. And because of that, I'm not sure what type of basketball everybody likes watching, but this is fun for me to watch these guys play. And just to see guys that are going to get after you for the entire 40 minutes. And as though they haven't already had 9 different pressures, now they go with the 1-3-1 three-quarter court to add another wrinkle into the game for the Virginia Tech Hokies to get used to.
And more film for Bruce Weber and company to watch coming up in that Saturday matchup in Manhattan. Lede stripped. And standing on the inline was Javon Carter. Will you think about West Virginia and this style against Iowa State or Kansas or Oklahoma this year and Buddy Hield and what he brings to the table? And there's going to be some fantastic matchups in Big 12 play.
I agree. I will definitely be tuned in to watch Big 12 basketball as the season goes along. And, you know, preseason, I picked Kansas to win the national championship, and I'm sticking with that. I think that they have exactly what you need. Bill Self has a veteran team. And when he has veterans, he's been successful. You know, they've gotten caught up, of course, with the one-and-dones like everyone else, where it's, to an extent, almost hurt their program. But now some of those guys have stuck around, Lane Selden Jr., Perry Ellis. And because of that, I think they have a very good shot to get on the net tonight.
Well, especially in a season maybe where there's really no truly elite team. A team like Kansas or North Carolina coming out of the ACC, if they get hot late, they can simply overwhelm you.
Absolutely. And when you have that type of depth, to when you do have injuries throughout the year, which everyone's going to have, but you've got guys that can step into place and take over those roles and play well. Kennedy Meeks out at North Carolina, but they don't have a shortage of bigs up front. You know, Roy Williams has the luxury of being able to go to the next man. Kennedy Meeks should be back, you know, as we get closer to the beginning of conference play. But I think North Carolina is another one of those Final Four teams that has a chance to get there. We've seen that before, right? Kansas and North Carolina in the Final Four. It's happened before.
I think so. Let's look at the ranked teams inside the ACC. Virginia, of course, back inside the top five, had an early loss to George Washington. It was also a pretty good program, by the way, in case you're sleeping under a rock lately. Lead is 17 for number 19, West Virginia. Approaching 8 minutes to play here inside of Castle Coliseum.
This is the area of maturity that Bob Huggins wants to see in this team. With this lead, can they continue to keep the pressure on Virginia Tech in comparison to allowing them to get back into the game? Carter actually slipped at half court and may have turned his ankle. No contact or anything, but we saw him go down. It's almost like he went to take off running and slipped and rolled his ankle.
Justin Bibbs was cramping a few minutes ago. He's back in, 10 and white for Virginia Tech. Offensive foul here against the Mountaineers. And Carter limping off to the sidelines. The lead is 17. Thank you very much. Rob Gray Jr., one of the pleasant surprises so far in the AAC. Meanwhile, back in Blacksburg, the balance scoring, Corey, in play once again for WVU.
And Devin Williams did all his damage in the first half, hasn't played a lot in the second half. Daxton Miles actually was down on the floor, grabbing his right hamstring, and Javon Carter just went out with an ankle turn. So West Virginia taking a couple of bumps and bruises here to their starting backcourt. But the reserves, the guys coming off the bench that are now on the court, this was the group that actually established the lead in the first half. So Bob Huggins not concerned about there being any drop-off for his team as they come out of the huddle.
Meanwhile, the foul fest continues as this game lingers into its third hour now. Two old rivals, we thought it would be physical, and it has not disappointed. Corey Alexander, Roy Philpott, glad you could join us today. These two programs have signed up for 10 meetings. Even though one resides in the Big 12, the other in the ACC, another steal. That's Iza Ahmad. This is the fourth of those 10 contests. West Virginia dominant last year in Morgantown, dominant so far again today here in Blacksburg.
And I believe Virginia Tech actually won the first two of this renewed meeting. Eric Green, of course, having a big game for the Hokies when they got it going again.
Four on the shot clock for Page. And an air ball. Now Nears turn it over. And Virginia Tech gives it right back.
And we talked about you can't reach for loose balls against West Virginia. You better get on the floor. And they do, and turn it into points on the offensive end. And they've done it so many times today. As you see the scrum, and Seth Allen just moves with the basketball, there's always going to be someone coming. Phillips coming up with the basketball, turning it into points at the other end. West Virginia, we talked about what they do, with points off of turnovers. Now 23 for the Mountaineers in this game with the opportunity for another here at the free throw line.
Phillip, the fourth Mountaineer in double figures, now with 11 points for Bob Huggins' team. And the Mountaineers will back off some of that full-court pressure.
Well, they're going to the 1-3-1 now. And if you're, you know, Bob Huggins, of course, he's still trying to find out things about his team. He needs to see how they can operate in this 1-3-1 in live action. I'm sure they use it a lot in practice. They may have used it early in the season. But he's got conference play right around the corner, and he needs to make sure that all of his defenses work when they go and have to go, of course, and play at Iowa State and at Kansas. You know, fog out of the ring. He needs to know these guys are confident in what they're going to do.
Tuning in looking for South Florida and Houston. That game has started on ESPN News. And don't forget New Year's Eve on ESPN. It's a college football playoff. The semifinals, the games we've been waiting on all season long. First at 4, Oklahoma Clemson. Then at 8 o'clock, it's the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic between number 3 Michigan State and second-ranked Alabama. Both games are on ESPN. Streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app. It truly is the most wonderful time of the year. You've got conference play starting in basketball, playoff, now in college football. I have not yet received Corey Alexander's official pick in the playoff this year. Who do you like?
Well, you know, I've had to go through this a number of times, and, you know, of course, my heart is with Clemson. My head is with Alabama, but I'm going to scrap all that. This is my prediction. I'm going Michigan State.
The Spartans.
I'm going with Spartans. Clemson hurt me with the suspensions. I think they're still going to beat Oklahoma. I think they'll still go in the championship game. But after Sparty pulls off the significant upset, Mike D'Antonio beating his former coach, Nick Saban, to get to the national championship at that point, I think Michigan State runs the table.
Well, what a story that would be. I'm going to disagree. I think the winner of Clemson-Oklahoma wins the national championship. That game's going to be close. I think it's going to be high scoring. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Well, if you've tuned in to any of my games throughout the last couple of weeks, I picked all four teams at some point. So in one of those games, I was right. I'm just going to let you know that now. One of those games, I was right.
We're going to send you to the Dino Gaudio School of Football Broadcasting because Coach was breaking it down Monday night in Chapel Hill.
But Coach Dino can break it down at any time. I mean, like I say, he and I have actually been on the court together, believe it or not, breaking down offenses as well as the way to play pick and roll. So if Coach Dino is picking a team, I might have to ride with his side.
Phillip now with 12 points. Junior from Brooklyn leads West Virginia in assists coming into this one. Pierce and Bibbs go back to the Virginia Tech bench. Seth Allen finally back in with those three personals. An air ball by Hudson, out of bounds to WVU. Well, Buzz Williams in year number 2 after a successful run at Marquette. He's got his team at 8-4 coming in. They were 11-22 last year. He knew it would be a rebuild, so it's going to take some time. And we've seen flashes from the Hokies in his first 18 months or so on the job. But the ACC is not going to be forgiving. He's got to grow some guys up in a hurry this season.
Yeah, and one of those guys, of course, that he was banking on, Chris Hart, breaking his foot in a workout over Christmas break. Had successful surgery yesterday. They still don't have a timetable as to when he will return. But a very important piece to what Buzz Williams had planned to do this year. Already 3 double-doubles, and Chris Clark leading all ACC freshmen in rebounding and averaging close to 11 points per game. So a big loss for the Hokies before they get to conference play.
You talk to some of the folks that follow this program closely. Clark was considered one of their top recruits in the last 15 years. So a big-time get for Buzz Williams and company. The up and under, the finish, and the foul. Dexter Miles Jr. make that Jayshon Page attacking the rim. Boy, it's hard to tell the difference at times between Page, Miles, and Carter.
If Page gets out in transition to Eurostep, and the finish to make sure that he doesn't pick up the charge. Great body control by Page.
Hey, Corey, they're all, here's a look at Chris Clark, freshman from Virginia Beach, out with a fractured foot. We look at Page, 6'2", 210. Miles, 6'3", 200. Javon Carter, 6'2", 200. These are stout guards that are not going to back down from any challenge you throw their way. They can shoot, they can attack the rim, and they can also defend.
Not only are they stout, their heights are exaggerated because those guys are not that tall. I went out on the court and said, I know Dax Miles pretty well. And he may be 6'2", but he's the only one close to that.
Timeout for the Hokies, one remaining, 4:41 left. Turnovers, we knew it would be a big factor coming in, and in fact, it turned out to be exactly that.
It's always a big factor when the Mountaineers are on the floor, but early in the game, they turn those turnovers into offense. Javon Carter, of course, coming up with the steal, but everyone getting involved in the action, and they share the basketball so well. A team that passes the ball and has great chemistry, and they get on the floor. Every loose ball, you're going to see a blue jersey on the floor going after them. And more importantly, when they get it in their hands, they are looking to score.
Mountaineers only 4 made three-pointers today, at 53% from the floor. The steals and the turnovers on track for their season average, which, of course, they lead the country in both categories.
And a good test for Bob Huggins and his team, because coming into the game, he told us, I'm not really sure what we have yet. He admits they haven't played the toughest schedule that they're going to see, especially compared to what they're going to see in the Big 12. But this was a good test for them, especially on the road, to come in. Well, we can call it a road game, their first true road game of the season. However, they may have just as many fans here as the Hokies do in Castle Coliseum.
Williams back in, comes up short, Henry the rebound.
And Williams still hasn't scored in the second half. And I'm sure he's not really even concerned about that. More important for his team to get the win.
Bob Huggins calls Devin Williams his hardest working player. He's humble, he's hungry. And with under 4 minutes to play, quick stop on the floor, we'll step aside as well. Virginia here in Blacksburg.
This is the starters, but when you come off the bench with Monte Brandon, Devin Booker, they have depth in the backcourt, which is something Leonard Hamilton hasn't had for a very long time at Florida State.
You know they'll defend if they can score a little bit more consistently this year. Seminoles are going to be a very tough out. Well, Henry's had himself quite a game for Virginia Tech. One of the few bright spots. Down low to Holt in the miss. And a shot clock violation. Shane Henry with 12 points. A couple of rebounds. The senior from Decatur, Georgia for the Hokies started the first 6 games this year. And there you see number 0.
Holton needs a sub. He's holding that left shoulder and waving to the bench to get him out of the game. That's not a good sign, especially as you're going into conference play for Coach Huggins.
And Holton getting set to exit as Nathan Adrian checks back in. Pick up his third personal in the process. Anything the Hokies can take away from a game like this before NC State comes to town?
Well, they won't see this type of pressure versus NC State. I don't think that anyone in the ACC provides this type of pressure that they'll see. But what you take away from this, if you're Buzz Williams, is this is the type of level that you have to perform at. And more importantly, you look at the other side and say, guys, this is how I need for you to defend. It doesn't necessarily have to be the full court, but you need to play with the same type of defensive effort that West Virginia plays with, because any team, I don't care who you are, if you play this hard defensively, you're going to be successful regardless as to what you can do on the offensive end. You're going to be successful if you can get your guys to buy in and play this hard on the defensive end of the floor.
It's a 10-point lead for the Mountaineers at halftime. It's 22 now, approaching 3 minutes to play. And a steal by Allen. Well, the other thing for Virginia Tech, if Chris Clark is able to get back in the mix at any point, super talented freshman out with a broken foot, that's certainly going to be a big help later on this year. But quite frankly, they don't know if he's going to be back or not just yet. It's too early. He just had surgery yesterday. And hey, credit to Chris for coming out here and supporting his teammates publicly this afternoon.
I know that young man very well. Had the opportunity to spend a lot of time with him coming through high school, and he is as competitive as they get. So he's going to be involved with the team, doing everything that he can to get back on the court. And, you know, when you often look at how many games has a guy played when they get hurt, and the cutoff number is 10 to be able to get a medical redshirt, and he's actually played 11 games. So that won't be able to happen for him this year. But hopefully he's able to get that foot back together and rehab and get back on the court for the Hokies at some point during the season.
Foul go against the Hokie, Shane Henry. Both teams in the double bonus. And a reminder, if you're tuning in to watch the Cougars and the Bulls, that game is currently airing on ESPN News. We'll send you down to the Sun Dome as soon as we're done here in Blacksburg. Leading scorer in the American Conference, Rock Gray Jr. for Houston. Certainly a player to keep an eye on there. My good friend Mark Wise on the call of that one with Alex Fowle. Should be a lot of fun. And yes, indeed, league play is finally here.
Offensive rebound opportunity for West Virginia. They don't have a starter on the floor right now, but the production does not drop off. You know, they backed off the pressure. They're not going full court pressure anymore, but they continue to execute, and I'm sure Bob Huggins have to be happy with his team. You know, coming into their first true road game and really performing the way they have, but more importantly, doing it with all 10 or 11 players in comparison to just five guys showing up.
Four to shoot, Adrian. Back iron. I'm not buying what Bob Huggins was trying to sell us earlier today as Allen attacks. A hard contact from behind. He's putting it out there that maybe he's not quite sure what this team is made of and questioning perhaps the toughness, wanting to see more. I think he knows the hand he's been dealt this year. And, Corey, I think he loves it.
Are you accusing the Huggy Bear of selling Wolf tickets? Is that what you're doing right now?
I won't admit it to him to his face. But on national television, why not?
Well, he already said that you don't talk. So, I mean, you owe him one. You got to go back at him.
I think he likes this team and maybe looking for a couple of more ingredients. And you see him, he's still coaching them up, including his star.
Hey, this is the first time I've seen him live, and I like this team, so I can't imagine how he does. I mean, when you think about a team like this that plays so hard in games, can you imagine being in that practice when they're playing against each other? I mean, that's something special right there. I mean, and when you get guys, I mean, and this many guys, again, it's 11, 12 deep. They are bought into the system and the style of play, and he's recruited the personnel to be able to do it. But, you know, Bob Huggins, of course, this will be win number 776 in his career, fourth active all-time Division I coach. So he's been around the block a couple times to where I believe his guys feel like he has some credibility.
Macon tickles the twine. A beautiful-looking shot. With under 90 seconds to play, this one all but a foregone conclusion. West Virginia's going to improve to 11-1. They'll leave Blacksburg today, head out to Manhattan, Kansas, and get ready for Big 12 play on Saturday. Boy, this will be a nice little momentum boost. It's been a quality non-conference schedule, maybe lacking the marquee win. But this one, their first true road game, this one means a little bit more.
It really does, and you hear the fans cheering. A strong contingent of West Virginia Mountaineer faithful in the building.
Adrian the miss, and Henry clears for Virginia Tech, and then gets it right back. Ahmad the end one. And that'll be it for Shane Henry, who fouls out.
And just fitting that the game ends the way that it has begun, with the steal and turning defense into offense for West Virginia.
And the chant breaks out. Of the WVU faithful here in Blacksburg.
All this really does is makes me want to go do a game in Morgantown. I'm sure that it is an amazing atmosphere there.
WVU Coliseum, you're not going to find too many better. Friends out in Ames, Iowa may have something to say about that. The Hilton Magic that typically goes down in that league. Allen Fieldhouse, of course, but yes, one of the great environments. And with time winding down, that's going to do it. What a performance for the Mountaineers. Javon Carter leads the charge with 18. Jayshon Page with 17. As WVU improves to 11-1. Virginia Tech falls to 8-5. League play begins on Saturday. And for Bob Hawkins, another impressive victory. Our final score, West Virginia 88, Virginia Tech 63, as the Mountaineers win their 11th game of the year. Now we take you to the Sun Dome in Tampa, Florida, as Houston takes on USF.